Long
They
time.
completely
Okay.
overexploded and then now I'm even sure the reserve as uses now that in this case
no
for
comment.
these
Is it cheap?
No, Australia is way more expensive than Germany.
Two times.
I mean, they have like
a radical explorer.
Yep, radically explores. I have it on my thing as well. I've got like, I radically explore the known and unknown.
So
the tagline.
Know, something like this,
it's interesting, like the
so
way
what,
it's changed
what is
over
this?
The years. Like if we go to archive.org.
So here, like this one is like every
yeah.
50 milliseconds. It
it's quite funny. Like
blupton.com.
For a while, it was
and
so good.
100.
I had a really
so
nice
it
website.
So set interval is like. So
and
this is a visual
like,
thing.
It's like,
let's see it through the times.
Yeah, yeah, well, just 1 second. So, and where do you get this information? I don't know. For
so it's like fake.
Cody,
how does
it structure?
File upload progress, maybe.
Let's see, what was it in
2009?
When did you start coding?
As a kid?
Yeah, as a kid, yeah. Yeah, when I was like eight.
Eight?
Yeah.
Okay. I have to go home now. You too,
or what? No.
Ah, so for example, this one maybe.
Yeah, because I started with 32.
So.
How old guys?
The same?
Okay,
31. I'm
35.
String 4.
I'm
just
like, it's
just something moving by time.
Getting longer by time.
No, this so
did
this one is a module.
Or
and
ever?
You can.
No, she didn't get any.
I had this by time.
She does, she got into blogging.
Yeah, I know this.
Until now it's like
yeah, yeah.
But
yeah, that's
true.
So you
do, nah,
don't
not everyone's cut out for it. See, so this, I really like this one. This is probably my favorite. This is what it was in 2010 and 2011. Isn't this one... Yeah, like the peak of like how good my website looked, right? Like, isn't this a really nifty website? So that's like my projects, that's like the articles I wrote. Yeah, and then like that's like the things I did. And look at that transition. Look at it. Look, see how the odd and even ones go different ways?
Yeah, but I need to, I mean...
Isn't this amazing?
If I now have it like this way or it goes here or whatever, it
does. See? And then I got my little coffee thing. Buy me a coffee.
Yeah, but this is like more for
I really like this website. Yeah. But then like see if I click on this, it's gonna take us to like an even like cooler page. Oh, it's not gonna do it. Or is it? Maybe if I open it.
Yeah,
like
but it
this,
doesn't matter. I just need to upload a file and this is Ajax. So
see, look at this, see? And then like you got like the trail history and like this was all like an Ajax website as well. See, so it gives you the stuff, gives you like
this,
the features.
The
how cool is it?
The browser knows how much
the the browser, I think
see?
The browser has
and then I replaced that website with this website. I don't know, I was just like, oh, it's easier.
Yeah.
See, and then that, then I replaced it with this, right? But, yeah. No, that's what it was earlier, before this year. See how it just had this little beginning bit? It didn't have the, all the year by year breakdown and the I'm Human 2 stuff.
Yeah, I mean, maybe
see,
it's
it just
like,
had like this little
maybe
pitch
it's
thing.
It's like object page, it's on fast.
See,
yeah.
So now, you know, it's got the little pitch thing here, but then it's got, you know, all the rest
I mean,
and everything.
What I would say
so it's a lot more personable.
When this page
right, so it's still got the awards.
Can click, it knows a number, how big this is. How big the links are, how many kilobytes or whatever.
Yeah, and like the
and
typography is just so nice.
Click.
Yeah.
And then the new
I really like that one.
It grabs the data, and the data arrives, and because I know already before how much I'm...
what happens if I... Oh, no, well, I'll show you one thing that I still have. Okay, this is a little Easter egg on my website. Watch this.
I want to receive, and now it's coming in, It's like 20%, and at some point it's 100, and then I show.
How cool is that?
So to implement something like this systematically for a complex page is like a lot of work, I think. And one thing is basically the visualization, if it's like a circle, and the other thing is if you send like a file or you see the file, where do you get this information from?
Yeah. It actually looks better on here. The refresh rate up there isn't too good.
Interesting. I think I didn't do this yet. So this one is like
For
all of those who want to see it.
But where do you get the so the progress? This one is one thing. Like
see,
the progress
like
bar,
here I don't have anything. It's just like Web 2.0 architects, security, and so on. That's it. What happens if I click clients? What happens if I did that?
Do you still have everything with the same content?
Yeah, except it was a PHP website, so it's a bit hard to. So there's like my clients that I did. Oh, what happens if we do continue reading? What did it actually say?
One is like a bit more tricky too. I think
this was such a good website.
Searching for some time.
It doesn't actually. It was a website, like they made products for like teachers and schools and stuff. I did the whole website, website. Check it out. That's true. The different pages had different slogans. Like this was a randomly generated slogan.
I mean,
so if we go through like a whole bunch of them, then we should get like, I think there was like four or five.
Like a JPEG
or right, so that one's the brains one.
JSON file. And you can measure the size
one.
And you can also measure
one
the
of them was really heartbeat.
Of the download
does it
upload?
Give us the little icon?
But usually I don't do this, so
it should be like a little icon as well that shows up like hearts.
It's not so much work. It's more like to know. It's like probably 10 lines of code.
Yeah, like randomly.
What,
yeah.
So I have to search for.
Oh, because there should be like a little heart symbol here. That's really good. And these are the days, and that's the days when you had tags for everything, right? Like the tag clouds, just like an opacity hide, But I still have like some ease. Like the other thing I really like is this contact button opens up a little modal. See, and then
like,
it got
like
support options, consulting options, contact options, expectation, and like the donate thing. But then the other thing I have here is this, if you want to support me, you can donate, and that takes you to the donate page or my referral link, see? So then you can... Yeah, sometimes, like every now and then, like once a month someone signs up for something. So that's quite good. But what's really nice is like, see how it's got the short URL? But if I like refer someone to something, I just type like, I can just type in like Coinbase and then it'll use my referral link.
Yeah,
see?
Okay, we can do this. We just need like a space.
Is that cool?
When do they have time? Like,
so like every short link on my website has like its own
so there is
little thing. So if I go
like
BALupton.com and then like
I'll
show you. I'll show you the source.
Yeah, so this is one thing where we could present, but they said they only have time on
I think if enough people sign up, like Airbnb, I got like $60 or something.
From 9 to some, like in the morning, and then they have something in the afternoon. But like, I think
They're all things that I actually use. See, so these are all the links on my website, right? So I got PIAC, you know, things like that. So this is like the actual link, and then these are like aliases, right? So like, but then at the bottom on my referral stuff, I say this is a referral and that should be like the color of the link, right?
I'm not sure about the
things, so then like if you want to go to like my CV, then it's just like, you know,
blupton.com/CV,
right? And that's going to redirect you to the resume, blah, blah, blah. But the other thing, which is really nice,
I mean, we have
is we'll see.
Scribe.
Huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah, Coffee Script right now. You see? So in my actual code, I do link like that, right? And then that's going to replace with the proper link and the correct stuff. See, so that's like the header thing. Right? And the other thing that I have that's also a really nice secret bit of my website is if we view the page source.
But the old office, they rented for...
We're also going to see some things I've cut out that I don't want to be that public, but I still think it's probably useful.
Yeah. So we could ask them, okay, we would maybe teach some programming.
Yeah.
And we could ask them if they would...
See, so I've got like one thing in here, and it's about like my first... Anyway. Maybe this.
Basically for geeks.
Yeah, I think so, yes.
Yeah, but it's really cool, though.
I don't know.
Yeah. I wonder if we get the word wrap on.
The hidden messages, you know, in the...
Yeah. Yeah, so it's good because like I still like I don't want to just erase the code for it. Oh yeah, see there we go. At age 9, I encountered pornography. and then on the new year of, you know, Y2K, I downloaded my first illegal MP3.
You're not you're remember.
Yeah, right? I mean, like, the first time you download a song, right? And they're like, what video games they played. See? So it's really cool. Yeah. And then there'll be, like, one about, like... Yeah, I think it's funny. Because, I mean, like, that's important to me for, the, like, you know, for time hierarchy and everything. But it's not important to the reader, like it adds no benefit to the reader, so it's just in a HTML comment. Do you see what I mean? Yeah. Yeah. See, so there is benefits to this website compared to the other ones. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, they maybe have it like...
Just like this one. That's ultimately the best one, isn't it? People just want to see my face up real big. That's the reason they go to my website.
News.
Let's see.
No, we'll it should get... be. It's, ah, yeah, true. Yeah, actually, yeah, you can say that for news.
Let's see.
You won't say it actually. I'm not. It's true. No, it's true. Actually, you
won't. Stars. We're in here somewhere.
Where's this guy? White tech something.
Okay, here we go. So this is it. I just specify like a transform on everything, and it just changes like the width and the height. That's pretty much it. And then that's like the rotating thing, right? So I just make it really big, and I get it to rotate 360 degrees.
So why doesn't it happen all there?
All where? Oh, because it's absolutely positioned. Yeah. So the top left is always going to be the same thing. What I've done is made it bigger.
Creator's hack lab.
So and it's got the flip.
It's the space. Here's also like some picture.
But see how it's got, it needs to load like a different image, and that's why there's like that initial delay while it switches the actual image out. And I haven't been able to figure out like a good way to get around that. Unless I load the big image initially, but then that's like it. You know, it's a big image, right?
That's true, but it's depending on here.
Yeah, but I mean, like, it's such a like a tiny part of. Oh, see, look, see, so that's what happens. Did you see that? So that's what happens when it's still using the old image because it's got the repeat. Do you see? Yeah. Yeah, but it's so cool because like it only does it on the hover, right? So when I touch it, it's like when my mouse goes off and then on, it changes the image source. I think everyone here is just like Ben is the biggest egoist. Nina, why do you invite this narcissist? Okay. What's going on?
But yeah, I think it's maybe the same as for us. Okay, it's a bit more far. Okay. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this space we could ask and they would probably allow. And
Yeah.
Needs maybe some notebooks or they should get some notebooks. I don't know. I mean, in the worst case, what I'm always thinking is this one. Like this one is really
so it's like, let's go to when you met me, right? Like this is it. I should say. I also visited Berlin to train students in JavaScript, like Nina. Yeah. So, yeah, there we go. See, and yeah, so that's like the bit, right? I got a full-time income from my planet, right? And I got to fly.
He can now switch, okay, to have this, like,
yeah.
Resolution, like, blah, blah,
yeah.
If you don't care for anything.
Yeah, so I was earning 6,000 USD a month from my planet, and then Jose and Kai, they flew me over, like, the flight and everything covered, and then I did couch surfing, but I got a 500 euro stipend as well for the 4 weeks.
I mean, yeah. Something for 149.
But what
6,000?
Yeah, they're all new.
6,000 USD, yeah, from my planet. So that was like for dockpad maintenance.
Sorry? Yeah, everything. They have everything.
Myplanet.io.
It's also like.
So they're like the one of the biggest web design firms in Canada.
Something. When it loads. And it slowly, of course, increases. And they use just all.
Yeah, so they're using dockpad for their clients. Jekyll. Yeah. So they were using Dockpad, and then they needed to solve like the content management.
So this one, I mean, it looks okay, whatever, I don't know. But the thing is, it's also cheap.
No. WordPress has been around for an incredibly long time. Oh, well, so Dockpad is a static, like it generates static sites, and WordPress is a dynamic site. So a dynamic site re-renders every single time it gets requested, and then it needs to hit the database, it needs to hit a cache server and things like that. When a static website just generates a static HTML file, that doesn't change. Right, so then all it needs to do is just send the result data. Like, it doesn't have to hit a database or anything. So you can get like a million visitors to your website at once on the static site, and it's not a problem.
And then they would,
right? When WordPress, like getting 1,000 visitors to your site at once would probably kill it.
And so, and here it would be possible basically to.
Well, no, unless they do like some caching thing, but then it's still hitting PHP, which is a dynamic language.
So you have warranty. If it breaks, you can give it back, and they send you a free repair.
Yeah. Yeah, so see, so like, what will happen is you will get start. What the hell?
I mean, we could do this, just it should be fast.
Yep,
because, like,
all by myself,
like,
all by my lonesome. See, so you create like your layout like this,
for some time,
create your index page like this, create like an about page like that, and then it will actually generate like the actual output for you.
Or we can check.
I don't think it'll.
Like,
yeah. So it's all templates, right? So
probably January.
As in, what do you mean by that?
I guess. Yeah, I mean.
Well, yeah. So people could like pre-made templates that look really nice or whatever, but this just handles like rendering.
Yeah, I don't know.
Right, so you make this file here, and it does like that, and then it will like you specify this. You should use this layout. And therefore, it then gets wrapped in this, right? So this bit here goes into content, and then this bit here goes inside title, right? So then that gets spurred out to the index.html
file. Yeah, why not? Oh, sorry, I'm too loud.
Yeah. All right, but okay, we should probably do something. What does people? Okay, you've got a really good JavaScript person in this room who's been doing open source for a very long time. What would you like to learn from me, if you do want to learn anything from me?
Yeah.
I would like to know how did you? I mean, you started this, but what was the inspiration? Why did you do this? Because I would like to do some useful things. But to do like business.
Okay.
You know, when you have to find the right thing.
Okay, so how do you pick the right problem to work on? Okay.
Okay, that's not really JavaScript.
Yeah. Well, I guess if you're doing open source stuff, then it probably is, right? Because, you know, if we look at my open source stuff, like 9,000 stars, 2,800 stars, but that's just those ones. Like, if we go to, like, the Alaptonaut projects, and this is, like, all the ones I've been involved with, like 9,000, 2,000, 2,000, 950... blah, 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 right? So,
okay, you obviously found the... how do you say this? Okay, so you have an idea of what people want.
Yeah, I guess. All right. So would that be an interesting topic then to cover or no?
Okay. I mean, that's my question. What about others?
Yeah.
Not
quite. Right.
Well, but what is the general topic about?
I mean, he is like quite successful open source developer that is like in JavaScript for 20 years.
Well, not 20 years. JavaScript hasn't been around 20. Oh, no, actually, no, maybe it just has. But
no, you started coding with 8.
I started coding 20 years ago. 20 so, yeah. Years.
And he's learning from that. So maybe he can give us some tips. And he's, you know, you have these community people who are actually willing to fucking share and to tell you what is the secret. And then you can ask, I mean, secret, how do you do this? How do you do that? I don't know. Where did you get your first money? Who was supporting you? Blah, blah, blah. You can ask him everything. I mean, he's here.
So we approach it. You should have sent my website in so that everyone has, like, the questions to ask, I guess, right? All right, so I guess we'll just cover, like, how I got involved with the open source scene or, like, the program, and then, like, how my career has developed over time and how that was impactful.
Yeah, and maybe...
And why open source?
Yeah.
Yeah, why open source? Like, how would you...
Yeah, that sounds very interesting.
Somebody who now starts, if he wants to make a lot of money, if he wants to do social projects, if he wants to... Because we are different people here. Some wants to just have a good job.
Yeah.
Some want to earn a lot of money. Some want to make an impact.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, let me just pull up, hopefully, actually, I may just, I'm just going to turn the display off for one moment while I pull up show mirror arrangement. Because I'll pull up my earliest website, and then that'll explain a lot about how I got started.
Did you ever work for anyone? Like, full-time, normal?
Yeah. I've worked for a year being an employee. The rest of the time has been working as a freelancer. But... previous things... All right, we can put this back. Okay, yep, there's nothing sensitive on my screen right now. Actually, I can probably just keep... Oh no, that's going to be too complicated. Alright, there we go. So we're back to being mirrored. Alright. Alright, so if we go to one of these really old ones, blogs, web archive. Alright. So back in 2005.
When you were how old?
Let's find out. See, this is for me to remember things, right? Okay, so yeah, 15, 16. So, I did my first website when I was 8, 1998. It was actually part of a school thing.
You had computer science in school?
So in Perth, in Australia, we do a test when we're 7. And that's in year 3. And then the top 1% then gets enrolled into a thing called PIAC, which is then you get to pick the subjects you want to do instead of subjects that you already know. So then you go to specialist schools and then you learn like computer hardware, you learn web design, things like that. Yeah, as like a really young kid. So then I did, my first one was web design back in 1998. And then after that, I did computer hardware, I did astronomy, I did orienteering, I did other things. But so then when I was 12, I started high school and I was doing night school and I was learning these, getting my certificates in these languages. So Cert 1, Cert 2, Cert 3, Cert 4, so trade certificates.
Wait, night school means like after school?
Yeah.
Where do you get
So in Australia, we have in our education system we have primary school, and then we have high school. And high school is till year 10, which is when you're 16, and then 17 and 18. No, wait. When you're 16, you're in year 11. So when you're 15, it's year 10, and then you can drop out after year 10. So when you're 16, you can go do your own thing. But year 11 and year 12 is necessary to get into university.
That's like very similar to Germany. But
I mean,
if you want to get like certificate of
about
one of these
languages. Yeah. Like so instead, we have a thing called TAFE in Australia. So TAFE is showing for blue collar work, when university is showing for white collar work, and we can enroll into, you know, like, let's get our certificate one in programming and we'll learn blah, blah, blah. And then once you get your certificate one, you can then do your certificate two. So we'll say, okay, courses, and we'll say English, study areas, types of study, I don't know, maybe IT. That's probably what they have it under.
And library?
I don't know what the library thinks about. information technology. So then we have, okay, certificate one, web-based technologies, certificate four, and program. So I got this. And I got the web development one as well. So course subjects. So there you go. So that's all, like, all the different units you do.
And this is after school activity.
Yeah, this is so as night school, right?
Yeah.
So like,
it's
two nights.
For the others to apply, it's not non-Australian.
I think everybody can do this. I don't. Here we go. International students. International can apply through our online thing. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, like, I was there when I was a kid, and then other people were there. So, like the TAFE thing, I think, is fairly easy to get into. So.
And does it have a good reputation?
I mean, it taught me how to program. So, yeah. I mean, like.
You need certificates. We can make certificates. Ben can give course and give you get a certificate.
Yeah. So we have this thing, and then. I learned, I got my certificate four in programming and my certificate, and then I got my diploma in web design. My diploma of website design and development. Okay, let's look at that. So this is all doing night school. So then by the time I was in year 11, all right, let's see what's in it. Training providers, student outcomes.
And this is still the
course
same.
Details. I don't know. I guess so. I just put in the same thing. All right. Yeah. So that's like all the skills that you end up building or whatever. And then this certificate, this diploma, then gives you access to university. So then instead of doing year 11 and year 12 of high school, I went straight to university. So I was 16 and 17 when I started university.
Because you could skip because of this.
Yeah. Because of the diploma. Yep. Yeah. And the other thing that I also did was I also started blogging. And we will see, this is my blog when I was 17. Look at the little pretty picture of me. Right? So, yeah, I was blogging, as teenagers do, right? About daydreaming on blossoming relationships, right? Whatever. So... Yeah, back in 2006, 2007, whatever.
Why was that from Jenny?
See?
Yeah,
there was something from
Jenny.
That was more about Jenny.
From what?
Jenny was mentioned.
I don't know. It would have been a girl that I partied with.
No, pretty good new questions.
Because you know on Facebook how they... Was anyone around in the early days of Facebook when there would always be those questions, like 100 questions? And it was pretty much like, what's your mother's maiden's name? What was your birth year? Right? Like all the social like questions that your bank uses to verify who you are, right? Like were all the ones you were answering on Facebook. Oh, so.
Like, which
yeah. Yeah. So that was like that. And I put it on this blog, right? But then the other, so this blog was powered by a thing called B2 Evolution. So originally, there was a project called B2 back in the 90s, and that was for writing blogs. And then the maintainer of B2 got board. And then B2 was forked into two projects. One was called B2 Evolution and the other one was called WordPress. And WordPress ended up being named the official continuation of B2, right? But the one I picked was B2 Evolution because developer-wise, it was a lot nicer than WordPress's spaghetti code at the time. Which may still exist today. In one form or the other. So I started writing plugins for B2 Evolution. And if we go to the forums somewhere, we will see.
Plugins.
It won't be on that, but it'll be on the forums these days. We want to search for forums. There we go. And if we search, I don't know, B. Lupton. There we go. So I started posting like skins, and I started doing like plugins for it, but doing like a lot of plugins I made. And then eventually I got added as a contributor and then like a maintainer of B2 Evolution, just because I was writing plugins for myself. I was making skins and I was making plugins, and I made like a gallery plugin that was quite popular. So this gallery plugin.
Hey.
Everyone's here.
Yeah.
Yep.
Come. Ben is showing us a little bit of and you're supposed to join.
Are you high?
Are you highest?
I think you're not real.
Okay, so
he's very high.
There's
a couch. You can sit on the couch. And there's munchies there, if you want munchies.
You cannot do
that. What the fuck? What happened?
You cannot imagine how much I trip. And then I just can't do it, you know? And you appear like the craziest fuckers, you know? You know, really serious shit. It's the best trip I've
ever. So the next one who's having presentation. You can tell us how to get high and stay there.
Okay. Wow.
Only in Berlin, huh? Yeah.
And this is a hacker scene, so imagine.
Yeah.
What's out there?
Yep. Yeah. Good atmosphere. All right. So, trying to beat that. All right. So. All right. All right. So the. Big plugin that I made was a gallery plugin, right? Upload your photos, manage your photos, do galleries within your blog post, right? Fairly basic. I don't know if any of these did one. Maybe there was. Maybe
so
there isn't.
So at the time, it was still kind of WordPress, B2 Evolution.
Yeah. So like, okay, the Wayback Machine isn't going to do it, right? So I started making plugins, and this one got really popular really quickly. And then soon enough, people started saying, hey, Ben, you've made all these plugins, you're also like a maintainer now, can you start writing plugins for us, right? So I started getting someone from England, Sue Kendrick from a publishing company called Rightlink. She actually started paying me to write plugins for her, right? And these were open source plugins. And I was 16, 17. I was like, hell yeah, I want £200. This is amazing. Right? For open source things.
But how did they pay you? Just like that? Like PayPal or no PayPal?
Yeah, it was PayPal or bank transfer or something. I can't particularly remember. It was a very long time ago. No, it was invoice. I was all legit and everything.
Yeah,
I'd sent invoices and everything. Yeah, so I started doing open source plugins and started getting paid for them. Also had first relationship and heartbreak at that time. Then I went to university, and that was really good, and got to experiment with everything. But then I started really picking up my JavaScript skills. I started really enjoying JavaScript, and JavaScript was getting more popular. And I made the first jQuery Lightbox plugin. So in these days, you'll know them as modals or like gallery plugins. It should probably still work. And it'll be amazing if it does, because it's code that hasn't really been touched, right? So here's like a little plugin, Vroomp, right? So before, there wasn't just jQuery. There was jQuery, Mutools, Prototypes, Scriptaculous, a whole bunch of other ones, right? And jQuery was like a newcomer, and they didn't actually have a Lightbox plugin. So I went and made this, and this one got very popular in the jQuery days. And this is the days before GitHub as well, right? So these days it would be like on GitHub, lots of stars and everything. And this is my hometown, right? So it's a pretty hometown. So,
yeah.
Yeah. See? This little thing here? Did you have that? Ta-da! Right? So, yeah, so that one worked really well. And, you know, that was like my first intro to fame. And I mean, like, I took everything seriously. I had good installation instructions, good usage information, good demos, things like that. And I always had, like, this little thing at the bottom, like, please donate. And sometimes, like, people would donate and, you know, that would be good. But mostly the thing that I was trying to do was just make useful things that other people used or, like, just useful things for myself. And then other people kind of started doing them. And then that was fine, doing jQuery plugins. But then in 2009, I realized I was just writing PHP just for doing JavaScript. And I kind of realized this because in 2008 or so, if we go back to my website... I took up like a normal job. It was 3 days a week or so while I was doing university with a platform. All right, I don't actually have it mentioned. So I did a job for a CRM company called Platform Interactive, and I was doing PHP. But then I kept getting all the interesting JavaScript stuff. Whenever they wanted to do something groundbreaking for a client, they'd always get me to start doing it. And so, like, things like state management, I was actually doing back in, like, 2007, 2008 kind of thing, before anyone else was doing state management on the client side. And I also ended up, they needed a calendar system for their, you know, CRM, right, to manage when posts are going to go out and things like that. So I ended up building Google Calendar, but for the CRM. And then I said to the management, I'm like, this is really good. We should open source it. So we should release this as its own product. This is a good idea. And this is before Google Calendar was a thing, right? And they didn't listen to me. And then they also bought another company. And as part of the merger, they gave everybody new contracts. And the contract pretty much had something in it, which is anything that you think about during our work, you know, during your time at work, we will own. And this is a very standard contract in Australia. So I resigned and went back to freelancing. And that was good because, you know, I had lots of friends now in Perth and was able to do freelancing. And, you know, I started then doing like education research solutions. I think they may now have a different website. But this is an education company. So this is just through, like, I worked for there was a web developer called Dean Usher. He already had clients. He had been freelancing for a while. Okay, this isn't the website that I worked on, but it's still the same company. Oh no, it's .com.au, I think. So what happened was when I was doing my TAFE diploma. Yeah, so my diploma in web design, one of the guys was called Dean, and he ended up going to freelancing. So when I was doing my job at the company, and then when I was doing my uni, when I left the job, he had already got built up a client base, and I emailed him, you know, got chatting, and he's like, hey, do you need any help doing you know, your freelancing stuff? And he's like, yeah, I've got a inkjet wholesale website, and I've got this education research one, can you help me do them? And then I ended up taking over the education research solutions one, and they paid me for about 2 years doing freelance work for them. Not that much, but it was good for you know, that time. And it gave me a lot of experience managing e-commerce websites, working with that, doing security to make sure people weren't screwing up with serial numbers or sharing serial numbers, doing authentication. So that was all good. That was with PHP.
And all remote.
Yeah, all remote. And then I was doing Whereas, yeah, uni started continuing on. In 2009, I ended up deciding, let's just do JavaScript full-time. It's not probably actually mentioned here. But then I moved to Sydney.
Wait, what was this?
Let's go into... Where?
What was terrifying night terror?
Where? What?
Having one night,
terrifying night terror. Oh, yeah. So I did a whole lot of drugs and ended up crazy for like an entire year.
And I, 16, I was, 17?
Huh?
Your age was like
18, 19 when I did all the drugs.
Was it still cold?
Huh? Oh, I was out of it that year. I was like hallucinating and like in a corner, like rocking back and forth. I did too many drugs. all right, this one should probably tell me when I was doing things so I have the stuff. Yeah, 2008, 2009. That's when I was working at Platform and then, yeah, doing freelancing and stuff. So that's all fine. But then in 2009, back when JS was now becoming a thing, and I was like, okay, client-side JavaScript is a thing and I'm just writing PHP so I can do JavaScript. And so I decided, okay, I'm just going to do JavaScript from now on. And I also, at the same time, there's a project called Aloha Editor. And these people were the first, okay, now it's all over, I guess. Let's see if we have anything to tell us about this. Tech doesn't live too long. So Aloha Editor, as you may know these days, actually, I wonder if Halo is still open. No. So before you used to have, when you wanted to edit content on websites, you may know this one, right? So you had a thing that looked like this. It was like a big box and you edited your content inside it, right? But then a HTML5 technology came online called Content Editable. That allowed you to actually edit the website's content, right? So if I go to like blupton.com and then I say inspect element, and then on body, I then add content editable equals content editable. All right. So now if I go to my thing, see, we can now, okay, apparently content, did I spell it right? Let's just try get rid of that bit. Oh, there we go, see? So I'll close this. Yep, so it's just like a HTML tag, see? And then it turns your website into something you can actually edit. And then, yep. So, you know, if you want to mess with somebody, go to the website and then start typing things and then send them an email and say your website's broken. Right? So, anyway, this tech came out, and that was really nifty because it's a new technology and no one really knew about it. And then Aloha Editor was something like this, where we now gave you a dialogue and you could actually edit things. So that was the first time I was like, hey, maybe for website editing, it doesn't need to be inside something like this. Instead, it could actually be inside where you actually edit the actual website and then you click like save up the top right corner or whatever, right? So this was really interesting. So I started contributing to this project and I realized, okay, the JavaScript stuff wasn't too good and I could really help. So I ended up contributing with them and then I became like the lead developer for like 6 months and then they flew me over to Vienna in Austria to participate at the Aloha Editor DevCom. So it was like a 2-week conference and that was really awesome, like a big hacking thing. And that was like the first time I got to, you know, I got to leave the country, all expenses paid to do the stuff I wanted.
Yeah, for us it sounds like a Vienna. Australia.
Yeah, right? This is a very expensive thing.
Yeah.
So like, and we'll have like a little video somewhere. Benjamin Lupton's life.
Oh,
all right. Aloha, there we go. Da-da-da. See, so this is like at the conference thing and I'm saying like, oh, that's one of the dudes, and I go around and I see everybody. That's not me. Somewhere I think they flipped the camera onto me. Oh yeah, at the end. There we go. And then I'm like, hi, mom. Whatever. So that was really cool. So that was really nice. And then as soon as that ended, I went and landed in Sydney. And because there was no work in Perth for web development stuff, like our web development meetup was like 20 people. And that was like for all of web development. And it happened like once a month. And that was the Ruby meetup, but that served as everything's meetup. So I moved to Sydney, and then that was really good. And their specific JavaScript meetup was like 50 people. And I rock up there, and then they do the whole, is anybody new here? And I was like, well, I'm new. And they're like, okay, give us an intro. I'm like, I'm Ben. I wrote a thing called History.js. And at that point, I had also wrote this library. So I'm not doing this specifically in chronological order because my mind is a bit fuzzy. So when I was attending that Perth meetup, just before I went to Sydney, but I had written this project, so 9,000 stars. And it pretty much instantly became popular. Like as within like the first week, it had like 2,000 stars, which is a lot back in 2011. And the reason this came into being was that I attended the meetup, and then someone at the meetup presented a talk about the struggles with the HTML5 history API, so state management in the browser. And doing all this stuff for my own projects and then doing the stuff at the employer, I was like, hey, I have a lot of experience with this. And I, for the first time, I recognized, oh, other people are having this problem too. This isn't just Ben's gone down a rabbit hole and figured something out. This is everybody's going down the rabbit hole, but I actually know something about this, right? Like I have a good solution to this. So then knowing that now other people struggle with this, then I coded this up with like all my learnings from that. And I think, yeah. And then I started posting it on like Stack Overflow for all the questions that I then discovered people were struggling with. And I actually did something that was fundamental for this project to become popular. And it is here. So I wrote this little article that said why the hash bang is perhaps one of the worst ideas that have ever happened. And because everybody was using the hash bang, Twitter and everyone was using it. And it was dumb because it's a terrible idea. And then hashes were also being used, but they're fine with HTML4, but when you have the push date API, then there's no need for them, like the HTML5 history API. So then you start merging them and you have some issues. So then I talk about what's the actual solution. And this article really hasn't changed since I wrote it back, you know, in 2011. So what I did was I published the HTML History.js with this article. So that way, anyone who used History.js, anyone discovering it, knew exactly why the current things that they were doing were stupid, right? And not stupid because they're stupid people, just stupid because they're just bad solutions and they didn't know anything better. What so, hashbang. So it was used as a way, so if you wanted like an Ajax website, like if we go to Twitter right now, and let's say I now click on I don't know, maybe something that isn't sponsored. all right, I click this person, right? So this thing actually refreshes the page without refreshing the whole page. And so like before you may have remembered and it would have something in the URL like this, the hash bang thing, BL Upton. Does anyone remember that? Okay, so there was a stage where if you click the links, it would actually go via this. And what would happen is that to load this, right, first you load twitter.com, and that's like a little landing page, and then it loads the content, right? So you have two loads, and it's quite silly. When the HTML5 history API allowed you to actually modify the URLs directly. So it solves like all the problems really nice. But then for older browsers that don't yet support the HTML5 history API, how do you do it, right? How do you get search engine compatibility and whatnot? So there was like a whole bunch of different things and this goes into it. But these days it's not particularly that important at all because all the browsers now support the HTML5 history API when back then it was like only Chrome. right? And then Firefox, and they all supported them differently. So history.
This enabled you to write it without FireBind?
Yeah, so this did the latest way, but it gracefully fell back, like did fallbacks for HTML4 browsers. So that way, if someone could easily use the latest tech while still having SEO and still having a good experience for the old browsers, right? So I wrote that, and then, you know, fast forward, you know, 6 months, and I go to Sydney, and then I say, yeah, I did History.js. And like everyone in the room was like, oh, we use History.js, right? Yeah, so that's why I was like, oh, big companies are actually using this, more or less. But then that was surprising because it was incredibly popular, but because it was just like a drop-in library that people forgot, it didn't actually get any money or anything reward besides recognition. And it really hit me quite hard when Basecamp 37 Signals used this, and I didn't get anything from that, right? So pretty much every single service used this, including Spotify for a while, right? Except I didn't get any benefits from this. And so that was hard. So then what I discovered was like, okay, I need to solve a problem that, you know, that everybody's experiencing, or is a very common problem that I can solve in an elegant way that actually, you know, makes the existing way of doing things, you know, just seem silly. But I need to solve a problem that people are experiencing every day, and they'll continue to use the solution every day. So History.js, you know, grab the solution, you put it in, and then you don't have to worry about it. When I want to solve something where people experience every day, so that way there's more money opportunities and more impact. So then Jekyll came out, which is a static site generator. And it came out initially just as a little blog post, as an idea, as a way of saying, hey, it's a bit silly how our websites are crashing when we get like 1,000 visitors a minute, because they have to do a database hit, they need to communicate with the database and render the template, render the website. And that didn't particularly make that much sense, because, you know, you can only do so many requests on a PHP server at once. So then the idea was, why don't we render static files and then just serve them with Apache or Nginx, right? And Node.js had just become a thing, and I was using Node.js already to write the build system for Aloha editor, the HTML5 editor earlier. So I made Docpad, which is a static site generator which uses Node.js. Node.js, like, it's a perfect fit because Node.js does asynchronous I/O very easily, and it's with JavaScript. So pretty much all web development can probably be JavaScript. So here I talk about, you know, the issue with current dynamic websites, and then, you know, what static sites currently offer over them. And then we have like a comparison table in terms of like the general solutions, right? So we'll say the usual CMS, the usual static site generator, and then Docpad and the solutions, right? So this ended up, like, I worked on this on the side because I thought it was interesting, there was potential, and I had the deluded impression that this could one day replace WordPress, right? But in hindsight, it never did, and for good reasons. But I kept working on this, but when I moved to Sydney, I started off and I worked for like $20 an hour. That actually really equated to like $10 an hour in the particular project. Like, I just walked into a co-working space and I was like, anybody need a JavaScript developer? And everybody needed a JavaScript developer. And no one specialized in JavaScript. So I picked a niche that everybody needed that no one was doing. And that worked really well. So I started off doing like $10 an hour, $20 an hour, $40 an hour, $80 an hour, $150 an hour over the course of like 3 years. And that worked well and developed like my recommendations accordingly. So I always made sure that, like, even if I was getting paid like $10 an hour initially, I was always doing like trying to deliver the best thing I could ever get. So like I heard a good quote a long time ago, back maybe 2007 or so, and it was like, don't get clients, get raving fans. And that was always like the approach that I kind of went through. And then if you read like any of the recommendations I have, pretty much everyone is like a raving fan. So even like, you know, initially when I started off, I wasn't earning that much money at all, right? Like $10 an hour isn't that much, especially in Australia. But then, you know, 10, 20, you know, 40, 80, 150, right? So it worked really well because then, you know, I built up that network, but I just kept delivering good quality things, and then people kept talking, and then, you know, new projects kept coming and new projects, and I kept working it up. But then in 2013, I kind of kept running into the traditional way that Australia dealt with technology, and they didn't understand open source, and they kept wanting to own all your IP and have you sign NDAs. So I was like, okay, let's give DocPad a go and commit full time to DocPad. And fortunately, that ended up paying off. It actually, at one point before it did pay off, I got completely broke. And I posted on Twitter, I'm like, I'm nearly broke. I have no idea what to do. Anyone got some advice? And someone called Casper Tideman, out of nowhere. So he was following me on Twitter, and then he responded.
And you didn't even know who they
are. Yeah, I didn't know who he was. And he said, let's do a call, big fan. So I call him up, and he ends up, you know, he's like, okay, Ben, big fan of History.js, used it for ages. What's the problem? And I said, well, I'm nearly broke. I'm running out of money. He's like, okay, how much time do you have left? I've got about 2 weeks. And he's like, okay, how long do you need to find work? And I was like, I don't know. I've tried everything. He's like, okay, let's brainstorm some ways. And he's like, have you tried teaching or consult, like, you know, teaching or you know, reaching out to meetup groups and presenting? And I was like, no, that's actually a good idea. So then I got in contact with the schools and the presenting places, and I actually got like a few talks done. And he's like, okay, well, how long do you think it's going to be until you can earn money? And I was like, well, it's probably going to be like 8 weeks, I guess, if I go that route. And he's like, okay, well, how much money do you need then to tie you over? And I was like, well, let's say $2,000. And then he's like, fine, I'll send you $2,000, right? So like, amazing. Right. And this is like the first time, right? Like, because before I looked at History.js and I resented it because everybody was using it and I wasn't seeing any money. But then at this point, I realized History.js built up that network, right? Like a lot of people now knew who I was, and it allowed me to quickly be recognized and grow, right? And, you know, this guy, you know, really helped me. So then funnily enough, like I landed a client when I did my presenting at one of these things, and that tied me over for another 3 months. And then then DocPad got sponsored by MyPlanet at $6,000 a month, for an entire year. And they,
after these 8 weeks.
Yeah. Really? Yeah. Yeah. And then, and like, that's crazy because like, that was an opportunity where I was like, oh, maybe I'm going to quit or whatever. Right. So they ended up funding me for $6,000 a month, and they flew me over to Canada to train the company in DocPad.
How did they find you on this?
So they found me through DocPad. So yeah, they were already using it.
Meetup that you were giving talks?
No. So this is something else. Yeah. So the client that I had via Meetup, he had a t-shirt selling business. Yeah. And I was developing like a backbone JS interface for that. Yeah. So that worked really well, and that lasted for an entire year, and I flew to Toronto twice during that year, and I also was able to bring over my partner for the second time, and they paid for her to come over, and that was amazing. And I also got reached out to by Jose and Kai for Hacker Retreat, which is no longer up, and then that's how I know Nina. And the first Hacker Retreat in 2013 was in co-op, and I taught JavaScript to the people doing Hacker Retreat here. So 2013 was a very good year. I also flew to India to give a talk, and I went to Bali to set up a co-working space there. 2014 was a fucking terrible year. Because
after a brilliant year.
Yeah, because I cut my finger, the sponsor dropped off, and I got a stomach virus. And for 8 weeks, I was unable to work at all. And I was thinking, am I actually still making people's lives better? Right? No, but just like with DocPad, I was just like, you know, I saw it's like the disconnect between like us doing programming, and then like you don't see people smiling and stuff as they use your things, right? I was just like, am I just making busy companies more busy? Or like just making them less busy so then they can fill it up with more busy work. So I really got like really introspective and esoteric for you know, a good thing. And I end up like completely dropping out and burning out and just getting tired of everything. Yeah, yeah, because on my open source, I actually have a really great talk, a really great issue, and it's like, GitHub should help open source maintainers stay sane. There we go. So, all right, see, so this is my thing. It's got 40 unread notifications. This is every day, right,
and
of using GitHub back then, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, so that's like one day's notifications, right? And then I talk about this. And then somebody else, they end up posting one, Thomas Davis. And he's got like 2,000 unread notifications or something like that. He just completely gave up on the markers red button, right? So this is a whole bunch of prominent people just rambling on about how GitHub is making us go fucking crazy. Right? See, and then these are like different solutions, right? And like Isaac, you know, who now runs NPM, his solution was just raise a few million dollars and hire some friends, right? And it's like, yeah, we can do that in Australia, of course, right? See? Right, so that was all of us trying to like discuss solutions and everything.
It's horrible, actually. Yeah, you do stuff basically for
yeah.
free, and then it's
fun. And one of the other things that we've raised in this, which now GitHub has seems to have actually listened to, whether it was because of us or other people, was, you remember when it talked about your streak? And your streak was very important. Does anyone remember this? It used to be like, you've been doing, you've got a 100-day contribution streak,
uh-huh.
Right? And if you had a 0-day streak, it would be under a rock in a hard place. That's what it would say,
wow.
Right? So it really like provided like some moral, you know,
punishment.
Like, yeah, punishment, right? For not contributing. So that really sucked. And like, you saw this as well, because like this graph is fairly fine, right? But you had completely dark green, completely.
Yeah.
And then suddenly nothing, right? And then, so whenever you see that, generally send the person an email and then be like, are you okay? Is everything fine, right? So I've done that now to several people in the open source thing, and then I've had pretty good conversations with them because they burnt out.
Yeah, so once he had like a break.
Yeah.
Now he's doing something.
Maybe you should ask him.
Yeah, right. Just be like, "Are you okay?" Da da da. Right. So yeah, I completely burnt out. I worked at like a donation based vegan soup kitchen. And that was like fantastic because like for the first time, like 8 years of working at home alone, now I'm interacting with people and I'm giving them amazing food and they're donating and like I'm interacting with people, right? So I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. Like you see the value that you're adding. You don't have to like intellectualize that you're adding value. So that was really good. And then like I was just like, okay, I'm completely out of money. So let's try living on the street for a while. Let's see how that goes, right? And, you know, looking at things always like as an adventure, right? So that's fine. But then, you know, then in 2015, I was like, okay, let's step up this adventure thing. And I hitchhiked all through Australia, including like to Uluru, which is that ginormous big rock we have in the middle of nowhere. Just got to see that and whatnot, all via hitchhiking. So all up, it was 10,000 kilometers through hitchhiking. And that was really nice. No one raped me. Some people were really creepy, and I actually have a talk about the hitchhiking thing on my YouTube if you want to watch that.
Because it's in Australia, you really sometimes are driving in the middle of...
Yeah, yeah. I spent like 3 days, 800 kilometers from the nearest town.
With some freak.
No, just by myself in the middle of the bush.
Oh, fuck.
Right, why is this behaving funny?
Really, we're camping outside of...
Yeah, so this talk here, open mic, what I've been up to. So this one I talk all about my hitchhiking trip and then as well about the depression of 2014 and everything. So that one's quite interesting.
But would you call it depression?
I was fully depressed. I like saw a counselor and everything, yeah.
But what does it mean? Because I don't know, how do you recognize this?
I spent 6 months in bed.
Really?
Yeah,
but like,
I just woke up one night, like there were several things, like with my work kind of things. So like with the work, that was like 8 weeks of questioning everything. Like I, like the momentum stopped, right? And that's like when I realized, like you always, like now it's like, oh, meditate and things like that, right? But like the point of like meditation is so like you can catch yourself tricking yourself, right? Like Sam Harris puts that quite well, which is that you can get so caught up in like a current way of thinking, and maybe you pursue that into like a business for like a few years, right? And I had the belief that word, like DocPad could kill WordPress, right? I didn't have the belief that, oh, it's solving a different niche and it's a different market and they're going to work alongside each other. I was like, no, it's going to, I want it to kill the other one, right? Because I hated WordPress so much. Right? Yeah, and I just thought it wasn't good. But then, you know, I did this and I started realizing, oh, no, like, I came up with like a few different things there. I was just like, okay, technical problems only have a very short lifespan and they change a lot. And you need to find a really good niche, and it needs to be a very popular niche, and you also need to have ways you can monetize it.
And you're alone. I mean,
right? And you need to build a ginormous team to help you, right? And so the monetizing the team thing I didn't really do because I overestimated the size of that niche, right? I didn't just handle that niche, and I was too confident with the technical choices. I was like, I can do it all myself, la-da-da. Even though I built up like 100 contributors that were contributing to DocPad, I was still the only one that could maintain it because it was a very like monolithic code base, at least the core was, even though the plugin system was done. So for someone to understand the core, they had to invest a lot of time, right? So if I, you know, I went away and people still use DocPad, they still made plugins, but they couldn't update the core, right? So now if you're going to make a giant technical thing, make the core tiny little packages that then other people can fiddle with. Right, reduce the ability for main. I mean, like improve the ability of maintenance by reducing the complexity. Right, so.
But it's still alive.
It's still being used. Pretty much exactly the same people are using it. Yeah, but it doesn't solve like the content management thing that well. So like I thought about it, and at the same time React was coming out, and React, you know, shook everything up because it showed us how we were doing things quite silly in the client side. Not silly, like we did the best way we can, but again, in the same way like I wrote History.js or we did with DocPad, you know, you found an elegant solution to a difficult problem, right? And React certainly did that. So then I, you know, thinking about DocPad and everything, I ended up coming up with like, oh, I had several blog posts during this depression, and some of them are quite funny. Some of the, I think one is just like outright failure. Why is this printing? DocPad community seems fragmented. Maybe that's one of them. Nine closed. Better importer support. There's one, and I just say like, Operation Disassemble and Diversify. Right. So 2014. This is like it's become more and more evident to myself that I have failed to successfully delegate responsibility of DocPad out to other people so that the workload is distributed evenly into easily digestible chunks for all, right? And to have the chunks we do have be maintainable by a group of individuals who have the compassion and capacity to do so. So this is like a big blog post about all my failures of making DocPad, you know, maintainable by the community. And then like...
How crazy, man. Look at this. I mean, you basically... youngster make something crazy and
yeah.
You feel like shit because you didn't make it like yeah. Like,
well, I mean, when you're comparing yourself to Zuckerberg and Elon Musk, so yeah, this is another one, and I feel like I failed and everything like that, and whatever. But then I did my hitchhiking thing, and I did that without a computer and everything, and that was really good. You know, and I just re-energized and rethought about priorities and rethought about what's important to me. And I was like, okay, I have all this technical knowledge, like 10 years of technical knowledge and expertise, 5 years in a static site generator thing. How can I use this knowledge well? And I kind of developed like a 3-year plan. And like, this is like my latest thoughts on it. This article that I only published last week or earlier this week. So this is probably worth reading because it goes into all the reasons why.
Really? What?
Yeah. Hey, man.
It stopped working.
Huh?
It stopped working.
What?
The Wii.
No, it's active. No, I just have to carry on.
Okay,
yeah.
Then
yeah.
We'll come back later.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.
Yeah. So yeah, then I published this week because it just ties up like all my thoughts. But there's like a little thing in here as well going about failures. So like I also realized like everything that my planet hired me to do also ended up becoming like a failure in terms of it's not a good solution. So here, this is deprecating, right? And I just deprecate so much of like features of DocPad. So there's like deprecating that, deprecating this, blah, blah, blah. And then I move from CoffeeScript to ES6. So I, you know, start doing some proactive things. And that really helped. So like over the last year, I've just been like 2014 was like about accepting my failures. And then 2015 was about replanning what I'm going to do. And then this year was like rebuilding. So I ended up like submitting like one of my talks. If we go like blupton.com elegant. So at the beginning of the year, I submitted a few of my projects that I thought was quite nifty to a whole bunch of places. So I submitted it to 3 places and it got accepted for the Amsterdam one, Node.js Interactive for Europe. And I presented that like 2 weeks ago. So they flew me over to go to Amsterdam and covered the accommodation.
Like, I mean, if you're accepted, they pay for your ticket.
Yep.
And
yep.
Something else?
Accommodation. Yep. So they, although the ticket was a bit, because Australia is so expensive, I only have had enough accommodation for 3 days at their official hotel and their conference was 4 days long. So I did Airbnb instead, right? So I gave like a talk and submitted that. So I started rebuilding. Then this one talks a bit more about the other rebuilding that I'm doing, right? So yeah. And I've tried to do like talks along the way of, you know, what I've kind of learned along this journey. And there'll probably be more in the life thing. So like this one talks about like me leaving DocPad for a while and then coming back and then it works really well. This is just before the DocPad sponsorship, right? But this is when I'm earning like a fair bit of money in Sydney. And then, yeah, this one's like my burnout thing, like a while later. And then there's going to be one and it talks about why I do open source. This one I presented at Hacker Retreat in 2014. Mm-hmm. And then this one is why open source makes sense, just in general. That one was in India as well. So I've tried to like, you know, experiment with different things and whatnot. Yeah. So
what is the rebuilding phase?
Yeah, so right now this is what I'm going to do. So like I figured out like why I burnt out in 2014 and I was just like, you know, working at home alone, isolation. I was always the expert in the room, being a consultant, you often are.
But you were in Perth or
in Sydney.
Why didn't you go to meetups or something?
Sydney is a very business focused, like sociopathic city.
So like London.
Yeah, it's like a rat race thing. Like I spent 5 years there and I didn't develop any friendships. As soon as I burnt out and I stopped doing programming, no one gave a shit about me. Yeah. Like I would go to the same people and things like that and I'd just like get up and leave and talk to other people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they cannot get anything from
anymore. Yeah, exactly. When like in Perth and even in Melbourne and Brisbane, like every one of those cities, I go to the meetup and then I'm like, hey, and blah, blah. And then people will be like, oh, that's amazing. Do you want a couch to crash on and things like that? But I didn't see any nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah. So then, yeah, like Contentful, which is why I'm in Berlin right now. I'm going through the interview process for because they can solve this content management issue with static site generators. And
is this something that you would like to do?
Yeah, because it puts like the last 5 years of experience to good use, right? Because yeah, it was like, okay, loneliness, so working on a team is good. Having mentors in the future is going to be good. And then still working on important problems. So like technical things or social problems is going to be good. So I made this website. This is like another thing of like, finding like a system that is really annoying that I can improve on or like deprecate. Like what can I try and deprecate? So this website deprecates the, hey, here's the top 20 static site generators. Here's the top 10 static site generators. Have you seen these 5 static site generator like marketing blog posts? So I was like, screw it. I'm just going to set up a definitive listing of every single one. And then this is like a pull request thing. People can do pull requests and add new ones.
Excuse me, I need to go. Thank you very much for the explanation. It's really great. Yeah. And I hope that we can connect.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe. You're staying here in Berlin?
Until Sunday. Oh. And then I'll fly back. Yep.
But then you're going to drop
anything? Yeah. If the Contentful thing works out, then yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. See you. Yeah. 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 So I set this up.
This is your analysis. This is your competitor. So fuck it. If you already have a list.
Well, no. Like I did. So like this website is powered by DocPad. But like you know we can see by stars. And sort, right? But it's just good because it's just like another thing where I can deprecate something that people are silly doing, right? Like I just don't like redundant effort. It just doesn't make sense to me, right? Like if you can do one thing and it saves everybody a shitload of time, then that seems like a good thing to do. So that's DocPad right there, right? So for a long time we were like the top one in like JavaScript or CoffeeScript, but since then all these ones have come out, right? So now we have like good competitors, and they're good competitors for good reasons.
Yeah, because they're fresh. They could learn
from yeah. So like, and people can like, you know, update this YAML listing. So this is like the best place to go. So my plan now is like still to evaluate a static site generator. You still have to like go through, like you go to this website, you sort, you pick the ones in your language, you check out the documentations, blah, blah. It takes you like 2 months to pick one, right? You got to give it a try. So my current plan is to do a podcast where I interview the top 30, so like one every 2 weeks, and you know roll it every year, and so that way I can grill with them on how the static site generator works, you know what's the go, you know what's the benefit to consumers, what their particular niches, what problems they're facing. So then here there's like you know play the podcast episode, right? So then. You know, people trying to pick a static site generator can listen to the podcast episode. And this website gets 9,000 unique people a month.
Really?
Yeah.
It does already.
Yeah.
How?
It's just people want static site generators, right?
And so,
So the plan right now is to refresh this to be a lot more informative, a lot better, and then to do the podcast thing.
And some affiliation.
Yeah. Well, the podcast thing could probably get sponsorship from commercial companies. So we saw about a license, and there'll be like some, and it'll say like commercial.
Yeah.
So these are like commercial players in the static site generator world, right? So some of these will probably want to sponsor it. But then other like people providing consulting services or support services or theme services for static site generators could also want to sponsor, right? So that's currently the plans. And this one is really good because I get to interact with people doing the interviews. I get to talk to people who may be smarter than me or of equal competition, right, in terms of doing them. And I also get to unify the community because even like these people implementing them, they don't have time to find out what everybody else is doing, right? So now that I've decided, okay, DocPad has gone so far, we really need something else now, I can interview all of them and then talk about them. And I can be the one who knows what everybody's doing. So
and
then,
like, yeah, hey, you guys are doing the Ruby
and you guys are having that problem, and this, like, say, maybe Hexo is having one particular problem, and I can say, well, Grav has already solved this, and this is the way they're solving it. You should chat to them, right? And then I can also talk about the content management problem, which is what this talks about, because I just feel that the current generation of static site generators can't solve the content management issue. So that's why we need like a new generation, and I think that's going to happen next year, right? So my plan right now is to do this podcast and then try and get this new generation of static site generator to happen.
What's defining it?
Huh? New static site generator, I mean.
Yeah, what is defining the next generation?
So currently with static site generators, right? So there's been three generations of them. The first one, humans were the static site generator. We wrote static HTML, right? Yeah. The next one, we had desktop applications, and then they, you know, you typed in content and then it would generate a static website for you. But the content was inside the desktop application. Like these
like
things.
Front page or what?
So not front page. If anyone remembers, a good example of this would be LiveWriter. Microsoft LiveWriter. I wrote one myself, but it's like proprietary and I didn't actually keep it. So things like this, the
maybe images or something.
So it's like it's probably not details. Yeah, they don't care about it at all. Oh, wait, maybe it's this one. Yeah, it's just going to take you to the other page. So it's like a little blogging app, right? And kind of like Word or whatever.
No. Okay.
But like it would end up posting your little website to like some server or something, right? Mm-hmm. So you wrote like all your blogs in it and then it would generate. So like the database is off limits to you and the content is off limits. Everything happens via this little app and then it generates a static website, right? Then in 2010, we got developer-focused ones where the file system is the database, right? And but the problem is that with a file system as a database, you have all of these problems, right? So currently, every single time the data, like it has to start, it has to reload all of the content again because it passes the file system, puts it into an in-memory database, and then it renders that in-memory database. You make a change, and then it needs to update the in-memory database. But as soon as that static site generator closes, then it forgets everything, and it needs to reload it, everything again. So if you've got like a large website, and it's like 1,000 files, or like 1,000 documents, or maybe it's like a few gigabytes of data, the static site generator just like collapses, right? It just can't deal with that, right? And the other thing is that if you're, you know, you're updating content all the time, and like, let's say you update your about page's title, and then that title is then referenced in the menu that is on every single page. That means you now have to regenerate every single page, right?
Just figure out the
trigger. Yeah.
That's because of you, they usually fall asleep. But it's
yeah, it's pretty late. I just realized how late it is. Yeah.
Imagine this
recording. Well, I only have 24 minutes left on my battery. I didn't bring the charger. So yeah, we...
How do you solve that?
Yeah, so... And then the other one is, like, yeah, if you update that thing, then it needs to re-render everything, right? So then you've got this, like, you make one little change and maybe make that change a few times. And now you've got to queue this, like, 30-minute regeneration to happen on these large sites. And the other one is, what about team collaboration? What if you want an entire team working on content together? Right now, you need to set up, like, a network share drive where people are editing Markdown files somewhere, right? It's just ridiculous. So like the content management stuff in the current generation, it just doesn't happen. So then I say, okay, we can solve this by then decoupling the static site generator into these parts. So instead we bring the database out from it being in memory to an external database that could be CouchDB or RethinkDB. And these ones are good because they're both real-time databases that you can subscribe to, and they both have synchronization abilities across local and desktop, like your local computer and then the server, right? So you could go offline or whatever and then sync it. Then importing. So you then write importers around this database, so then it could import things from the file system, it could import things from Medium, it could import things from WordPress, it could import things from Instagram or whatever. Then you have then the rendering section also abstracted out. Right, and then you can render it to specific static site generators. You could render it to a mobile app. You could render it to whatever, right? So right now, and then you have, where'd it go? And then you have API extensions. So these are things like, you know, integration with Zapier or Slack or if then then that, right? So right now, Contentful is this, this, and this coupled, right? But that's bad because it really should be decoupled. And then there's this other bit, which is native interfaces. So these could be like desktop apps where you can now edit the content, or a website where you can edit the content in like a rich editor, right? But the, one interesting idea is you could have the content in, you know, one of these databases. You can write an API extension for it that then exports everything, you know, with a WordPress compatible API. So then WordPress's Calypso editing interface could actually edit your content, right? So people get the WordPress nice editor, but you and then you render it to a static website, right? Mm-hmm. So this kind of solves all the problems. So talk about, you know, the solutions. Why hasn't this occurred? Because we just didn't really think about this, right? Like we saw static site generators and we made them. But, and that was all fine, but we just never thought about doing content management, right, with them because they were still developer focused. Then we tried to add content management to it as like an afterthought, and it just didn't make sense.
How it's in WordPress, the content management?
Yeah, so WordPress, everything is bundled in WordPress, right?
So it exists, but it's all kind of...
Yeah, And WordPress doesn't have this concept, right? Because that's just your WordPress website. Yeah.
Real time.
Well, the export is just like things like exporting your content into static files, or exporting your content into other type of websites or things. Yeah. So using like the database as an API. So then like I then talk about, okay, who's actually trying to solve this? And Contentful is the only one actually trying to solve this right now, which is why I applied for them. And then I say, okay, so what proposals actually exist? How can we solve this issue? And we can say, well, existing static site generators can try and implement this currently, but they're going to fail. And then I introduce a big blog post about how DocPad have completely failed trying to do this, and it's just not a good idea, right? And then the other one is Contentful can try and improve their stuff to be more static site generator friendly, which hopefully when I work there, I'm going to be able to help them with. And then the other one is the community can start implementing the ideas that are talked about in this blog post. And then what I'm going to do, so I'm interviewing with Contentful, hopefully I can, help them solve this problem. I also want to see the static site generator community start collaborating, and I also want to see them start talking about, this content management problem. Then I will start experimenting with Contentful with DocPad, or, DocPad with RethinkDB. So experiment with the different options for solving this problem with DocPad, so with my own one. And then I will start talking with the other ones and then, do the podcast idea, right, to see how I can unify the community. So that's the current plan for, the next few years. And so I have, this three-year plan, which is either earn, money through Contentful or via doing consulting in Melbourne, or how they is, do this, which is the, implement this idea. And then, so that's my 3-year thing. And then in 3 years I reevaluate, right? But then I also have a 10-year thing, which is learn artificial intelligence, because I don't think JavaScript, because everything technical only has a limited lifespan. And I think JavaScript may risk, at some point it's going to become outdated. It's only a matter of time, just like anything technical. And AI is something that is only going to become more prolific. So that's my little side thing, which is try and learn artificial intelligence if I have the aptitude to actually do it.
But it's going to be written in some programming language? Or?
Well, yes and no and maybe or whatever, right? So I don't know. I still haven't learned it yet. So that's the thing, which is over 10 years to develop my skills in that. So in 10 years... if JavaScript is less relevant, or if it becomes a legacy technology, then I'm still going to be hireable. And AI is very interesting. So, in 10 years, being an expert person in AI should be fairly good, I guess.
It's not virtual reality, not.
No. So things like, fleet learning for cars, or, analyzing people's data. Pretty much my goal is the OpenAI thing.
I didn't check at the end what that's Musk's thing.
Or yeah, so Microsoft, IBM, Facebook, and some other company, Google, they've all teamed up and they've formed their own AI alliance, and it seems like they're going to start sharing data between each other with their AIs. This is very concerning because they have the data of billions of people, right? Everything. Yeah. So OpenAI is Musk's thing to try and...
So they wouldn't open it, they would just share it
amongst themselves. Yeah, so OpenAI is Musk's to try and make sure that if an AI is done, it's within the interest of the people. Actually, I think this is it. Yeah, this is Musk's one, right? So their idea is we need to make sure that AI is actually in the benefit of, the people, as in the public, rather than the benefit of the companies who do it. And... that seems to be quite a good idea, because I do not want the Matrix future, and I don't want the Wall-E future, and I don't want any future where...
it's also who makes money if at the end the AI is making money and it gives everything to them, so what are we?
Yeah. So that's just something which is it's just a defensive move for the future in terms of how can I ensure that my skills are still relevant in 10 years? So AI seems to be something that's going to be very relevant in 10 years. When JavaScript, I'm not too sure. right? Because, and I'll give you like one example where I'm not sure JavaScript will be. Do you remember like when people were talking about like, oh, the, like, we were always like, always trust the web or always bet on the web. Do you remember this? And then like, so, and this is like in the early days of iOS, and people are like, oh, you don't need to care that much. But then the iOS app stuff really actually started taking off, right? Like everyone's making mobile apps. They're not particularly that profitable, and it's very hard to become profitable, but it's a sizable thing. So my, I have like a little bit of a concern that maybe one day we're just going to become so app-centric that maybe JavaScript isn't going to be relevant.
But also iOS apps are built in JavaScript.
Swift and Objective-C. Like, they can be built in JavaScript, except it's not like the native language. Right? Like, you can't build a watch app in JavaScript.
No.
Yeah, but you wouldn't particularly want to because of the resources. You would want to keep that as native as possible. So, just trying to think, like, you know, what's... Like, Node.js is still going to be a safe bet, right? But my concern is maybe, so, like, Node.js becomes, like, the PHP of today. Right? So, it's just, like, a defensive move. Obviously, I'm going to still, you know, be really good at JavaScript. Like, I've maxed out my skills in that. It's just the technologies that I keep changing. So, like, React and things like that.
You are now with React?
I think React's a very good option.
Did you try this YoYo?
I saw YoYo. I when Alex showed it to me.
It follows the React idea.
Yeah. But it's just like, I mean, you know, that's a 10-year plan. Like, And then, well, if JavaScript doesn't fade out, then a JavaScript developer who knows AI is even more valuable.
But it's funny, what, you're now, 25 really, or what?
27 now.
So basically, yeah, in 10 years you're 37, so of course you have to have a plan.
Yeah.
It sounds like, yeah, 10 years, who fucking gives a fuck? Yeah. Kind of, yeah. But at the end, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. So that's the thing. So 3-year plan, do the static site generator stuff, do the podcast thing.
These static site generators, I never use them, so I really don't
get. So that's them. The thing, which is like right now, like Dockpad, like Jekyll is used by like the Obama campaign is like the biggest example of it. So like
Obama campaign.
Yeah. And then like Dockpad's been used by like Microsoft and Adobe and other people as well.
What is Trump using?
I don't know.
Which one is Trump using?
But like they have really good options and like they make a lot of sense. So the thing is, it's just like
I really thought all of them are WordPress, to be honest.
Yeah.
That's why I never thought like, what the fuck, why all this?
Yeah.
I don't know, you say, because it's really like just static.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're faster.
Yeah, well, faster for serving.
Yeah, I imagine that it's for developers, this thing, not so much for users.
Yeah. So that's the way. Currently, they're just for developers. And then this, like the post, the 2017 one, tries and makes them for end users. Or at least if this is implemented, then they are for end users.
Yeah.
Right? Like right now, static site generators are for developers, but then with hack jobs, we try and make them for end users. Like one example of making them for end users is pros. So this will give you a pretty little, whatever. Let's just trust pros with my life. All right. Bum, bum, bum. All right. Documentation. DocPath documentation. Yep, view project. Let's do it. All right. Start. Intro. Right, so it's like a little markdown editor, whatever, right? And you got to do it, and then it sends like a pull request, so like just commits it to the repository, right? So this is like a way of trying to make markdown and markdown repositories more end user friendly. But again, it's still like a little hack job because none of like, let's say two people are editing the same document at once, then one of their pull requests is going to conflict with the other one, right? So that's...
I would like to see something like TitanPad or these HackPads and at the same time to be able to build page because there you have just like one page, not like the menu bar. And all
that. So this is going to be quite interesting to me. So, and doing that podcast thing. So, and hopefully at some point, you know, the sponsors from this idea is going to bring in enough that I can live off. I think
what would be really interesting, probably to list consultants, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Because so this is like, you know...
Yeah, so the current plan is to like break this down to be like, you can filter it and it's a lot more. And then we talk about the consultants, we talk about the support people, we talk about which companies are involved, the hosting companies. And we actually give you all the details you need to pick, like, a static site generator. So, like,
it's basically like price comparison, yeah. But it's not price comparison.
Yeah, and also, like, if you need to try and convince your boss who's using WordPress, what are you going to tell them? Da-da-da-da-da, right? So this will become, like, the place. Like, right now it's just a place to, like, list all of them and eventually pick one, right? But it doesn't give you any more information besides the listing. And, you know, yeah, that's going to be what it is.
Would be nice also, yeah. Like top three or something.
Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, then it's going to get the interview episodes and everything, so it'll be, you know, quite good.
So you're going away from the open source in as such?
No, so I'm still, open source wise, I'm still actually doing a lot.
Do you have the same charger? No, fuck, this is really baby charger.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true, because I thought if we were presenting something, it would be using that port anyway, so we're going to charge.
USB.
Is it USB now?
No. USB-C.
Yeah, of course it's Apple. Maybe. Yeah. Just normal USB.
So currently, like, I'm doing a lot, and one of the things that I'm doing is this project, and this is what... There's two projects that my Amsterdam talk was on. Gilupton.com/elegant. This is my Amsterdam talk. And this one automates your readme generation. So it'll turn like this into the actual title of your readme, or like description and things like that. That'll do your badges for your readme. Right? That'll do the license information. That'll do the backers, right? So this entire readme is pretty much just that, and then like this is all automatically generated based on the information of your projects. But then there's other things that we're going to do. So like one of the ones I really want to see is
yours also. And you got like 142 stars.
Yep. So like this one, it's used by, I use it already in 130 of my own projects. And this, the other one is this one, and this one is a little bit more, I'll just say watch the talk on them, but see this one's getting a few downloads, so 6, you can't really see there,
6, 8, 7, 8.
Yeah, see, so it's getting a fair bit of use.
Oh, yeah, fuck.
So
wow.
All that, my
1,000 today, are you kidding me? What is this? Yeah.
So this one provide like picks which edition of your package should be loaded for the correct, like the correct environment. So if you've got two editions published, and one's ES Next and then one's ES 2015, and your environment supports ES Next, then it's going to load the ES Next edition. If your environment doesn't support ES Next, then it's going to load the ES 2015 edition, right? So it loads the best edition for the current environment. Yeah, so that's the talk there is called, let's not go to their website because it's quite bad, but it's Elegantly Produce and Consume Compiled Packages. That's that talk. So it's pretty nifty. So yeah, I still have a lot of open source general maintenance and everything to do. And just like, you know, just plugging away on these projects. Like, you know, I have 280 open source projects. So I'm plenty busy in the open source
world.
You
do modules a lot?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so I've got 180, I think. Let's see, npm. Is it npm.com?
npm.js, I think.
npm.js. Yeah. So this should tell me 180. There you go. Packages. So yeah, I'm still gonna be pretty busy with the open source world. Yeah.
Huh. How, when, what, fuck, when do you do these things?
Well, it's pretty much all just to build DocPad, like the ecosystem around building DocPad.
And now you're kind of putting it in the plugins, kind of. I mean, in the modules.
Well, yeah. Well, now I'm just going to have, like, a different, like, you know, all these modules, like, I still use. Like for asynchronous stuff, I use one called Task Group. That's amazing. For logging, I use one called Caterpillar. For testing, I use one called Joe. And Task Group's really good. So if you ever need to do async stuff in Node, you should check this out. So I'm running out of battery, so I'm just gonna end this right now.
It's funny because, like, if I